Okay, good morning again. So hopefully you thought of something. Hopefully you thought of a place, a space, a moment where you might have experienced God in your life. And I want a couple of people to share so we can hear about some of those experiences of experiencing God just in normal everyday life. So if you raise your hand, I'll come to you with a microphone. It's number one, Eric. Okay. So anybody raise your hand? Yeah? Okay.
Hello, everybody. I'm new to the church. And I just want to say that I've been touched by God and I've been blessed many ways, not just all the week, every day. And I humbly want to give thanks because I woke up today. I woke up, I opened my eyes, I'm breathing. I've been blessed with a husband who works hard. I have a home, a roof over my head. I have a beautiful granddaughter and 8 more. I have struggles every day. I'm alive. I didn't act on suicidal thoughts that I had months ago. And I thank God, and I struggled with depression. I'm just alive. And that's how I've been touched. I found a forever home in a church. And I thank God for that.
Amen. Thank you. Wow, I just felt God just then. Thank you. Thank you so much for sharing. Any others? No?
Yeah. It didn't take me long to think of a time, which has been recently. I had a car accident just before Thanksgiving. And it forced me to spend a lot of time in a chair in my living room, allowing myself to heal, not doing anything. And it was an eye-opener. I know that God used that time to remind me that there are other things besides running around and saying yes to everything. I'm grateful.
Thank you. One more. I think you guys know by now I like to share in threes.
My Packers.
Boo. Hey, I'm from Chicago. What can I do?
No, seriously. I attended a funeral this week of a very young cousin of mine. And the strength, the faith, and the love that I saw in that family was just, it had to come from God. It came from nowhere else. You could feel it in the church. And all three of his daughters had the strength to get up, talk about their God and their dad. The mom, the wife, had the strength to get up and tell her daughters what their father wanted them to know on his dying bed. One of the daughters had an amazing voice, and she's not quite a professional singer, but very, very close. And she was able to get up and sing a song about her dad, and it was so amazingly beautiful, and so much love was shared there. I just knew God was with us all.
Wow. Thank you. So we'll be doing this from week to week, sharing these experiences of God, experiences of the Holy. So thank you to the three of you who shared today, and keep that in your mind as you go throughout your week. Where and how am I experiencing God. And so, as we begin worship, I invite any children, youth, who want to come up and join me around the baptismal font, because this is one of the many places where we experience God, where we feel God through water and word. So we start here at the baptismal font, here where God was called, actually himself. Jesus was called by his cousin, John the Baptist, and said, "You are the Son of God." You, when the clouds parted, God said, "This is my beloved child." And so we remember, too, that we are all God's beloved children. So if you can, reach a hand in here and repeat after me. Say, "Dear God,
dear God,
thank you,
for calling me
your child.
Help me
to stretch,
to love
all people
in your name.
Amen." All right, so take a little bit of that water. Make the sign of the cross on your own forehead to remind yourself that you're a child of God. Get your hand wet again. Make the sign of the cross on somebody else so they will remember they are a child of God. And a third time, get your hand wet. And as you go back to sit down, get a few people wet so they will remember they too are a child of God. We begin worship today by singing, "We Have Seen the Lord, Nime Muona Buana." So if you would rise as you are able, and we will sing this in the original language. So if you just repeat after me, "Nime Muona Buana, Nime Muona Buana." Yeah, that's pretty good. You got it. And then there's just one other thing you need to learn. It's Ana Pendeza. Ana Pendeza. All right, that's good. All right, so I'll sing it to you and you can sing it back to me. Sounds like this. Nime mona buana. Try that. Nime mona buana. Nime mona buana. Nime mona buana, nime mona buana, ana pendeza. Nime mona buana, ana pendeza. Nice. So we'll sing that all together, and then I'm going to split off and start singing a call and response part over the top. I'll sing different aspects of who God is, that God is powerful, that God is merciful, that God is wonderful, and you'll just keep singing over and over and over again, "Nime mona buana, we have seen the Lord." And you might switch switch over into English. When I sing to English, switch back to Kiswahili when I get to that. Buana, nime buona buana, nime buona buana, nime buona buana, ana pende, nime buona buana, nime buona, nime buona buana. Seen the Lord, God is powerful, God is mighty, God with us leads us. We have seen the Lord, God is lowly, God is merciful. Gracious, worship the Lord, the one who heals. Come, worship the Lord, the one who forgives. Come, worship the Lord, the one who loves. We confess our sins before God and one another. Living God, you have given us all we need to follow you, yet we doubt ourselves, criticize others, grasp for meaningless pleasures, and seek hollow assurances. Forgive us for refusing to see what is in front of our faces. Restore us by the power of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. The Son of Man is powerful and yet compassionate. Take heart in the pardon that he offers. You are forgiven. You are beloved children of God. Your faith has healed you. Amen. Jesus, I've forgotten the words that you have spoken. Promises that burn within my heart have now grown dim. With a doubting heart I follow the paths of earthly wisdom. Forgive me my unbelief, renew the fire again. Pray our prayer of the day. O Lord, your words are sometimes difficult to hear. Turn our hearts in your direction so that even when following is a challenge, we rely on your Spirit to guide us on the path. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Now I need the help, some kids and youth to help me share a part of the gospel story for today. All right, and is there one of you, let's see, one of you guys probably, who wouldn't mind being carried? Can carry you? You, all right, thank you. All right. So this is what's happening, right? Last week we told the story and people are just finding out what Jesus is up to. So there are huge crowds are gathering all around him. And so Jesus is in this house and the place is packed, just absolutely packed. And there's no way to get even close to him. But, so I need, see, you guys will all be his friends, okay? So he's got a bad disease, and he's never been able to walk in his whole life. So can you just, like, lay down right here? There we go. He can't walk, but his friends have all heard that there's this man, Jesus, who could do something about it. So they wanna pick him up, and they wanna take him right to Jesus. So can one of you be my Jesus? One of you? Yeah, you want to be my Jesus? Okay, Jesus, let's see. Let's put you over here. All right. So you just, like, wait over there. And the rest of you are friends, okay? So we're going to help pick him up, okay? Can you guys come out? Come on over. We got to pick him up. Ready? One. Come on, somebody grab his arm over here. Ready? On the count of three, ready? Go. Whoa. We're going to carry our friend. All right. And we can't see a way in, so you know what we do? We climbed all the way up on top of the roof, and we dug a hole through the roof, and we let him down. Woo! We let him down through the top of the roof. And Jesus was sitting there, and he saw him and said, "Because of the faith of your friends, your sins are forgiven." Can you say your sins are forgiven? All right, now, there's some people sitting in the crowd who are some of the scribes, some of the Pharisees, some of the normal church people, and in their minds they're thinking, sin's forgiven? What do you mean sin's forgiven? He can't forgive sins. That's blasphemy. And Jesus, he knows what they're thinking. So he says, "Oh, let me show you something. You can say this. You think it's hard to forgive sins? What if I just tell him to get up and walk away? But just so that you can see, that I really do have this power. And then he told the man, get up. He said, get up, pick up your mat, and go. And so the man got up and he picked up his mat and he was healed and he was able to go. And the crowd, they were just shaking their heads in astonishment. What did we just see? What just happened right now? And word, but before the man left, he told them, hey, just don't tell anybody what happened. But he went all throughout the town and told everybody about what had happened. So even more people started to follow Jesus after that. All right, so can we all hold hands in a circle here? All right, repeat after me. Say, dear God, thank you for helping us and proving that our faith in you does matter. All right, thank you, guys.
First reading comes from Psalm 103. When people are crushed, wronged, enslaved, raped, murdered, the Eternal is just. He makes the wrongs right. He showed Moses his ways. He allowed his people Israel to see his wonders and acts of power. The Eternal is compassionate and merciful. When we cross all the lines, he is patient with us. When we struggle against him, he lovingly stays with us, changing, convicting, prodding. He will not constantly criticize, nor will he hold a grudge forever. Thankfully, God does not punish us for our sins and depravity as we deserve. In his mercy, he tempers justice with peace. Measure how high heaven is above the earth. God's wide, loving, kind heart is greater for those who revere him. You see, God takes all our crimes, our seemingly inexhaustible sins, and removes them. As far as east is from the west, he removes them from us. An earthly father expresses love for his children. It is no different with our heavenly father. The Eternal shows his love for those who revere him, for he knows what we are made of. He knows our frame is frail, and he remembers we came from dust. Here ends the reading. Please rise for the gospel response.
You may be seated for the reading of the gospel. So there's two different scenes here. We begin with the one that I shared with the kids. Some days later, when Jesus came back to Capernaum, people heard that Jesus was back in town, and many gathered at the house where he was staying. Soon, the crowd overflowed from the house into the streets, and still more people pressed forward to hear Jesus' teaching, the message of God's kingdom. Four men tried to bring a crippled friend to him, but Since the crowd prevented their carrying him close enough to get to Jesus, they climbed up on the roof. They opened up a hole in it and lowered the paralyzed man on his mat down to Jesus. Jesus recognized the faith of these men. Son, your sins are forgiven. Some scribes were sitting in the crowd, and they didn't like what they were hearing. To themselves, they thought, what does Jesus think he's doing? This kind of talk is blasphemy and offense against the Most High. Only God can forgive sins. At once, Jesus realized what they were thinking, and he turned to them. Why do my words trouble you so? Think about this. Is it easier to tell this paralyzed man your sins are forgiven, or to tell him, get up, pick up your mat, and walk? Still, I want to show you that the Son of Man has been given authority on earth to forgive sins. And so to the paralytic says, get up, pick up your mat, and go home. The man rose to his feet, immediately rolled up his mat, and walked out into the streets. Everyone in the crowd was amazed, and all they could do was shake their heads, thank God for this miracle, and say to each other, we've never seen anything like that. Another time, Jesus was out walking alongside the Sea of Galilee, teaching the gathering crowd as he went, and he saw Levi, the son of Alphaeus, sitting at the booth where he collected taxes. And Jesus said, follow me. Levi left the booth and went along with him. At Levi's house, many tax collectors and other sinners, Jews who did not keep the strict purity laws of the Jewish holy texts, were dining with Jesus and his disciples. Jesus had attracted such a large following that all kinds of people surrounded him. When the Pharisees and scribes saw who shared the table with Jesus, they were quick to criticize. If your master is such a righteous person, then why does he eat and drink with tax collectors and sinners, the worst among us? And Jesus heard them. And he said, people who have their health don't need to see a doctor. Only those who are sick do. I'm not here to call those already in good standing with God. I'm here to call sinners to turn back to him. The disciples of John the Baptist and the Pharisees made a practice of fasting. So some people asked Jesus, why is it that John's followers and the Pharisees' followers fast, but your disciples are eating and drinking like it was any other day? Well, guess at the wedding feast can't fast when the bridegroom is with them. It would be wrong to do anything but feast. When the bridegroom is snatched away from them, then the time will come to fast and mourn. These are new things I'm teaching, and they can't be reconciled with old habits. Nobody would ever use a piece of new cloth to patch an old garment, because when the patch shrinks, it pulls away and makes the tear even worse. And nobody puts new unfermented wine into old wineskins, because if he does, the wine will burst the skins. They would lose both the wineskins and the wine. No, the only appropriate thing is to put new wine into new wineskins. This is the word of the Lord. So we have to start with a few definitions before we can have a deeper conversation. So this whole thing is about sin or sins. And it was thought that, like the man who's paralyzed, there must have been something wrong with his relationship with God, or maybe something wrong with his parents' relationship with God, that something was wrong in that that relationship somehow needed to be healed, that the relationship between this man or this man's family and God needed to be somehow reconciled, brought back together. And, well, who can heal the relationship between you and God other than God, right? And so that's where the people who are watching are coming from, saying, wait a minute, you can't do this. You can't just heal the relationship between God and this person, although they don't know who Jesus is, apparently, because it is God, and God has the ability to do that. But then We land at the end here with another type of image, which also has to do with sin, that Jesus is sitting and eating and talking with sinners, people who apparently don't have a really good relationship with God. And as the church folk are gathered together, they're looking and saying, wait a minute, this new pastor in town is always at the bar eating with the wrong kind of people. I mean, is that really the kind of guy you want to follow? And Jesus says, well, who should I be eating with? Should I be eating with the people who already have a good relationship with God, or should I be eating with the people who maybe need to build their relationship with God, or maybe have a non-existent relationship with God? Isn't that where I should be spending my time and my effort? And then he gets to that metaphor at the end. So, I am new wine. And new wine just can't go into an old wineskin, otherwise it's gonna burst. So I don't know if you guys know anything about wine making. I do a little bit. I did a little dabbling in making wine and beer. And so one of the things when you're making wine and beer is that it breathes. It's fermenting, and as it ferments, it's releasing CO2. And as it releases CO2, it expands. And if you have an old wineskin, so wineskins are made out of leather, and an old wineskin, leather gets hard after a while. It stops being flexible. So if you put this new wine into this old wineskin, it can't flex. It's rigid, but this wine is growing and fermenting and expanding, and if that wineskin can't flex, it's just gonna burst. And I had that happen once because I was brand new at making beer, and so I had it ready to go, and all of a sudden I heard a boom, and I was like, what's going on? And I came in, the beer's overflowing. I'm like, oh no. I needed a pressure valve to release. I needed somewhere for that expansion to go, and the vessel I had it in wasn't flexible enough to handle what was going on inside. And so Jesus says, wait a minute, are you too rigid? Are you too rigid, you church, you people who think you have a good relationship with God? You're too rigid in your thinking to think that I should and ought to be eating with people who want to maybe restore a relationship with God, or maybe who are thought of as those people who don't and shouldn't have a relationship with God? What's holding you back? Why are you so stiff? What's holding you back? Let me stretch you a little bit. Let me stretch you into some places that might make you uncomfortable, is what Jesus says. That this stretching is good. It's necessary. And so I put out a video earlier this week, and some of you saw it. Some people responded. I got a few interesting things back. But most of the ones that I heard back had to do with relationships. Gee, what a concept. most of them had to do with relationships with people who you might keep at an arm's distance. This morning, actually, we started with a conversation that was based on that. We were talking about immigration and the history of this country and immigration, and that as every new wave of immigrants came into the country, the people who were starting to feel set in their ways, becoming like a rigid old wineskin, they just couldn't stretch enough when these new immigrants were coming in. And so with every new wave, they got mad and they got angry, and there was hostility and there was fighting. And even it started, you know, with people who we might think of today or just part of the group, right? So the Germans came, and the people who were already here said, well, those people are clearly not white. Germans, right? Those people clearly aren't white. They don't speak the right language, they don't have the right customs, and so we need to limit how much power they have in this country. And then eventually there was a new group of people, and so the country said, wait a minute, no, the Germans are white now. Now the Irish, they're not white. And so they put up new restrictions, they made life hard on them, and then there was a new wave of people that came in and said, well, okay, I guess the Irish are white. This new group of people is not white. And this idea of whiteness started to become rigid. And it's only these people who are considered white who are allowed in and who are accepted at the table. And now we find ourselves in a place where we're getting immigrants from even further places other than just Europe, and it's harder for people to consider me white. when my color of my skin is right in front of your face. So it was a little easier maybe to, for time to change and for people to look at the Germans and say, well, I guess we can convert them to white, and at the Irish, well, we can convert them to white, but I don't think I'm ever gonna be white. Not that I wanna be, but yeah, it's much more interesting to be Puerto Rican, right? But this idea of whiteness was this new rigid idea of who was allowed and who was welcome at the table. And this idea is becoming very rigid right now in this country, that there's a certain sense of there are certain people who are allowed at the table and there are certain people who we want to keep away from the table. And anybody who's over here eating with those people are getting ostracized. And that maybe people who care about immigrants and who want to give a home to them, who want to open up this country to them, are thought of as people who are contrary to what we're about as a society. And maybe Jesus is at work in our midst trying to stretch us once again to say, hey, wait a minute. There is a space at the table for every single one of these people. Even if they don't look like us, even if they don't sound like us, even if they have different customs, they have different types of relationships, they are deserving of a place at the table. And that's where we need to stretch. That's where we need to grow. And that's what this table is all about. That's what communion is all about, this table of mercy where each and every single person is welcome. The ultimate stretch that... as I say, you can come, and as long as you extend your arm out to Jesus, Jesus is going to reach back. And, well, maybe even sometimes when you don't reach out, Jesus is going to reach for you anyways. That at this table of mercy, every single person has a place. Every single person is valued, no matter what your background is, no matter what your skin color is, no matter what language you speak, whether you're gluten intolerant or not, there's a place for you. At this table. There's a place for you at this table. And one last thing I want to mention, I don't know if you caught it, but at the very beginning, that man who gets dropped off in front of Jesus, Jesus actually never says anything about the man's faith. Did you notice that? It says Jesus noticed the faith of his friends. Never noticed his faith. We don't even know if the man has faith or not, and he was the one who got healed. That sometimes we need to have enough faith for one another, that we can be a catalyst for others to begin that relationship, to be included at the table because of what we do, and maybe because of the way we live in the world, because we do open our arms up to those immigrants, those new people in our communities, that maybe others might be able to say, hey, I guess through their faith, in these newcomers, perhaps we can invite them to new tables as well. That as we host GED classes here, maybe new doors are open just because we're willing to host people here, because we're willing to sing in languages other than our own. Maybe people see that, feel that, hear that, and they say, ah, okay, maybe there is room for us in this place. Maybe every once in a while I say the words of institution in Spanish, and you're okay with it. And people see that, people hear that, people feel that, and say, ah, God is doing something here. And maybe God can do some healing in other people's lives through you, through your faith, and that God is stretching us, moving within us, taking us into new and maybe uncomfortable spaces. So throughout this week, maybe have eyes open for that, where God might be stretching you, moving you towards somebody who you might keep at an arm's distance. Maybe moving you in a direction where somebody else might say, really? They're eating with that person? But you're willing to go to the Gifts Men's Shelter or to Project 1649 or to Echo and volunteer, share your time, give your efforts. Eat with those who are in need of Christ's presence. And then you can be God's healing hands in the world. Amen. Please rise as you're able as we sing our sermon hymn. So now gathered together as God's people, let us confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, conceived by the Holy Spirit, and born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now let us pray for the church, for the world, and for all those who are in need. God of grace, we pray for all immigrants throughout the world. We pray for all people who are outcasts of society. We pray for those who find themselves estranged from their families because of their beliefs, because of who they love, because of diseases. And God, we ask for you to stretch this world to welcome all of your children back to the table. Lord, in your mercy. God, we pray for all those who are struggling through natural disasters. We pray especially for the people of Australia and the continuing fires, for the people of Puerto Rico and the thousands of earthquakes. And we pray for the people in the southern part of the U.S. hit by a terrible storm and tornadoes and ice. God, we want you to show up. To show up through first responders, through people who help, through people who donate. And we ask for you to keep all of those people safe, that you might be there in the midst of these difficult times, providing a peace that surpasses all understanding. Lord, in your mercy. God, we pray for countries that are at war and for countries that are contemplating it. We pray that your peace again might reside with them, and that you would guide all of our elected officials, that they might work for peace and justice for all people. Lord, in your mercy. God, we lift up to you all those who are in need of healing. We pray for John Spoden, Colleen Schroeder, John Tollefson, Ann Nazer, Isaac Johnson, Jean Arnold, Joey Pauline, Nancy Wilson, Mary Jacobson, Brian Whitney, Jamie Malfi, Joanne Malfi, Barb Nelson, Gary Johnson, Lowell Cobb, Pauline Pino, Audrey Brazell, Jody Ripley, and all those who we name out loud now. God, we ask for you to show up again in the lives of these people, and that even when they lose faith, that our faith might be enough for them. Lord, in your mercy. And finally, God, we pray for this community, for Faith Lutheran Church, that we might be ready for the stretch that you bring, that we might be taken into new places, into new relationships, that we might dare to open up the table to those the community might see as not worthy. And we ask for us to be able to live into our mission, to be your people, to be empowered by your word and sacrament to continue reaching out in love. Amen. And now may the peace of God be with you all. And share a sign of God's love and peace with one another. Please rise as you are able. Let us pray. We give you thanks, God, for all the gifts that you give to us, ourselves, our time, our possessions, all signs of your gracious love. We pray that you might give us eyes to see these gifts as gifts to be shared, so that all might know and experience your great abundance in this world. Amen. And so now we gather here at this table of thanksgiving, here at this table where each and every person has a place. This table, which happens not just here, but all around the world, that this feast of love is celebrated in every language around the world with different types of grape juice, different types of wine, different types of bread, with different types of skin-colored people coming to this table. And here, every single person is known and appreciated and accepted. You belong. You are God's child, God's beloved. And so we give thanks. We give thanks for a God who decided not to stay far away, but to come close and to build bridges for us, to build a bridge of relationship between us and God and between us and one another. And so with all the choirs of angels, we sing and we give thanks. We sing, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." Was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. And so in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord and Savior took bread. He broke it and he gave thanks and he gave it for all to eat, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks and he gave it for all to drink, saying, "Take and drink. This is a new covenant, a new promise in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." And so now, gathered together as God's people around this table, let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. As you come forward to this table, you may extend your hands to receive the bread and to dip it into the wine, which is red wine, or the grape juice, which is white grape juice. Here you can come and receive the mercy of Christ. Here you are forgiven of all your sins, and here you are welcome. Whether this is a favorite place to come, or whether you come today with doubts and concerns, as long as you extend your hand to Christ, Jesus will always reach back. So please come. The table is ready. And now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ grant you grace and keep you in his peace now and forever. Amen.
Hello. For anybody that doesn't know me, I'm Mike Murdy, and I'm the newest addition to the council and the stewardship committee, which is probably why I'm standing up here giving this talk. I'll keep it real brief so we can wrap up, but I got a couple quick points I want to make. Next week, obviously, we're having the vote on the annual budget. Everybody's had a chance to see it. There's information at the connections table that you can get your hands on to look at as well. I think it's important that everybody know what our goal is, that our goal is to raise $250,000 in pledged giving, and that's 70% of the total budget. And this is all going to be covered, I'm sure, well next week. I want to briefly touch on, I'm sure that there's always the questions, at least I know I have, is what's my fair share? How much should I give? And that's always a difficult topic, I think, talking about, you know, how much gets put in an envelope is kind of, at least when I grew up, it was such a personal sort of thing. Tithing 10% of your total income has been historically what people reference. Well, that's kind of Old Testament and Leviticus. I like 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7. I jotted this down. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. I sat down and I prayed this week to think about what I had meaningful to say to everybody sitting out there who has been doing this for so long and that giving is not new to you. But personally, I like the metaphor Emma and I came up with talking about. It's like when we go out to dinner in my family and there's a large group of us, family, friends, and we end up taking over a restaurant. And at the end of the meal has to be paid for, obviously, which is kind of like our operating budget. And the bill gets split up equitably, but not equally, because some people obviously have more means to provide and some people have less. And my brilliant daughter helped me with that, so I kind of like that. And it helps when I do that, just personally sharing, that I like to kind of know what the starting point is. When we're passing around, it's like, well, we all just had breakfast, so if I just figure that's, that average person was $12. Here, we've got those numbers in the budget that you'll see next week, and I'm sure it'll be covered again, but if everything was given equally at 150 shares at $40 a week, covers the 2020 operating budget. I also like to mention, last week, Scott talked to you all about the building fund, which is the part of the budget that pays the mortgage. And the similar number there is $10 a week meets the budget. So that was simple for me, just to keep in your mind next week, when we're talking about the budget and you're voting on it, to take a quick look around at the people sitting next to you and just figure out, like, we're all out to dinner and how do you feel about the meal you just had? There's a lot of different ways to give. You can give in the envelopes. I've always, I like writing out a check and putting it in there, but I'm not so sure that's the best way, and that's the most helpful for the church now. We've got a couple different options for online giving as well, and some people choose to give weekly, some people choose to give once a month. It's really a personal decision and up to you, and there's, in addition, I'll mention some people like to give one-time gifts. There's legacy and estate gifts. So there's lots of ways for people to give. But what we're really talking about with the budget next week and the vote is the day-to-day things that we have to pay for to make this mission run and to make everything possible. Kind of leads me to a quick close, I promise, that in thinking about this week and studying, I read Old Testament, New Testament. I was reading 20th century poetry. And I learned a lot about stewardship. And the Holy Spirit changed how I look at it. So if I could share something that just even thinking about this pledge drive for the week, what it did for me and how the Holy showed up in my life, it made me think about God's ownership of everything, and it helped me to see myself as a steward, and that's new for Mike. So I took the opportunity today to actually write down on my envelope, because I never did this right. All the years I've been given, I just put a check in there. And I actually wrote down how much goes to the building fund so the mortgage could get paid. So I guess it's kind of like growing up and picking up my share of the bill. I'm privileged to be able to stand up here and give this to you right now. And I thank you all for your trust in me and for your attention in this serious matter. I make joke about it, but you are all a blessing to me and to each other. So God bless us. I've got one other item. This is a lot less serious and a lot more fun. Make sure after service everybody stops downstairs for the baby shower. Thank you. Oh, and next week you'll have this wonderful flyer. If there's any questions about anything we covered, go through the 2020 stewardship brochure. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mike. And now, if you would rise as you are able for a blessing. May the road rise up to meet you. May the wind be always at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face. May the rains fall soft upon your fields. And until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of his hand. Amen. Now, as you go, do you promise to be people of God? I will love God and love my neighbors to the best of my ability. Do you promise to be empowered by word and sacrament? I will remember every day that I'm a child of God through baptism, inspired by the word and strengthened by Holy Communion. Do you promise to reach out in love? Go in peace and remember your promise.
Thanks be to God,
and we will.